All right, so our next speaker will be Jurka Hlinka, telling us about block skirmion phases by crystallographic symmetry breaking.
So I'm very sorry for this delay. I uploaded the talk just before my lecture, but somehow disappeared from the desktop. So it's always a pleasure to be here in this workshop. And I'd like to take the opportunity to tell you something about block skirmion phases and crystallographic symmetry breaking. The work is done with my young colleague, Casey Erb, which is also in the audience over there near the window. And the outline is basically to start with crystallographic symmetry breaking. Some new results about point group symmetry breaking will be presented, and then application to block skirmion phases. As an introduction, I'd like to make two statements. So first, any ferroelectric phenomenon is rooted in ferroelectric phase transition. And the second, whether a phase transition is ferroelectric one, one can tell if one knows the crystallographic point group symmetry breaking. And the reason is that if you know the information about point group crystallography breaking, we can tell whether polarization component is one of the order parameters. And here, of course, I think about polarization as a vector. Of course, I still agree that polarization defined on a lattice is a lattice of polarizations, but in the end, when you compare with the experiments, you have to count with one vector. So this is the vector which I have in mind. When we think about point group symmetry breaking, there are different ways how to describe what kind of breaking we have in mind. One of the concise and very useful way to describe point group symmetry breaking is to give a pair of groups, the high symmetry group and low symmetry group. And the low symmetry group of one domain state, and what is important that it, to give all information needed, it's oriented in high symmetry phase, space symmetry, point group symmetry. So for example, you can have symmetry, high symmetry 4-2-2, and the symmetry is broken in a way that you have only two fault axes in the end. It matters whether this two fault axis is on the place of four fault axis, which I would make this little symbol here, or whether it's parallel to the four fault axis. And you know, this kind of sorts of phase symmetry lowering are called symmetry breaking species, or could be called isospecies, because he came first with the nice idea how to make some kind of equivalence classes in the point group symmetry reductions. And we have previously, recently I presented also in this conference this list of all isospecies which are generated by 32 crystallographic point groups. There are 212 of them. And one of our new results obtained with Casey Erb is that we regenerate this table by an algorithm, computer algorithms, just starting with the 32 point groups, completely computer-wise. So we check that it's by this, we know it's 212. But what is more important, we now combine each of these species with a signature which tells you information about the vector and bidirector, all the parameters related in this to this symmetry reduction. So there is 212 rows. Each row has a sequential number. There is high symmetry group, low symmetry group, number of domain states, and there is this signature four circles. And I'll just explain. So for example, the one which is in the column associated with a straight arrow, this stands for polarization or polar vector. So if the circle is open, it means this phase transition has a domain state which cannot be distinguished by polarization. Therefore, it's non-polar. It's not ferroelectric phase transition. If there is a full circle, it means every macroscopic domain state can be distinguished by polarization. So it's full ferroelectric. And if there is a semicircle, like here, it would be in this column, it would mean that it's a partial ferroelectric. So some domain states can be distinguished by polarization, some not. The same is done now with the axial vector. So this symbol for axial vector order parameter, and we have then also this symbol which stays for a screw symmetry. So if you have screw symmetry quantity, you you can again define whether this different symmetry reductions corresponds to the domain state, which could be distinguished by the screw symmetry object. And of course, to be complete, we have also whether there is some order parameter which is just define a direction, new direction in the crystal. So we have these four signatures now linked to each species, each symmetry break, macroscopic symmetry breaking case. Now, because we have done it this time by completely computer-wise, not by hand, so the general whole table is actually generated by a computer program, we have to think about it, how to convey to the program what we would like to do, and we have to think it a little bit differently than before. And we have some nice, let's say, concept, a little bit different way of looking at this vector-like properties. And it's just coming back to the idea of dipole. So if you think about polarization, what is polarization defined, let's say, in the old textbooks before the modern theory of polarization, it's a dipole, basically. So it's a final object, just a lattice. We don't think about polarization. We have a single thing, which is a point group symmetry. And dipole is a positive charge and negative charge. And so the question is, can we do this for the other arrow-like quantities? So how about, for example, axial vector? Can I have something like charge, positive and negative charge separated apart and have its axial symmetry? So I need something like that, two-body object. Because to have the axial symmetry, I need to put something there. And the question is, what to put there? If I put there two same charges, for example, two plus and plus, it will not have the symmetry of axial vector. And so the idea came that actually what you could put there is something which is not electric charge, but pseudo scalar symmetry charge. And if you do that, you can actually generate all four. So if you generalize this idea of dipoles, then what all these directional quantities are about is about possibilities how to distribute two kind of charges, elementary charges distinguishable by symmetry. So for example, if you have right and left dipole, it has the symmetry of axial vector. And if you have two chiral scalar charges of the same size, you would get this chiral or screw symmetry object. By the way, you can easily extend it to time odd quantities, and you get eight different quantities because we can generate eight types of these generate dipoles from four kinds of scalars which exist in space-time. So now I'm getting to this, how to use that for skirmions. I think this audience knows about skirmions, so this is example of chiral magnetic system, which has in some portion of phase diagram this nice vortices, which when you make of magnetization, if you make a cross section, we have basically like tubes of opposite magnetization, which are surrounded by a rotating polarization around that point. These objects exist in some part of phase diagram of magnetization versus temperature. So, for example, in this material, it's just a very small pocket of the skirmion configuration. And interestingly, this was predicted some 30 years ago by Bogdanov and Jablonski within a very simple theory expression, which is analogous to this description of type 2 superconductors. And so ingredients of this prediction is that we need this kind of free energy expansion, what is basically expansion for uniaxial, easy axis ferromagnet with on-axis magnetic field. But what is important for this particular phase is a particular form of the Jelushinsky-Moria interaction. So suitable form of Jelushinsky-Moria interaction, the paper considered different possible forms of that. Here is the two forms which are interesting for us. They are slightly different because they are a little bit different numbers and letters. And what is important that to have a let's say, this Jaworzynski-Moria interaction in a given form, it's enough to look for the symmetry. So one of the predictions of the paper 30 years ago was that if you look, for example, for chiral magnets uniaxial in the DN symmetry, and if there is a ferromagnetic phase transition with like spontaneous magnetization nominally along this uniaxial axis, then you will have Bloch skirmions. So there was a symmetry prediction. I'd like you to draw your attention, if you look at these forms, it's actually one form, because it's differential form, it depends, it's linear in derivatives. And if you look for the change of coordinates, you will find out that it's actually axially symmetric expression, and the point group symmetry is the same as the helix. So it's a C symmetry, and this one is a symmetry of polarization. And so it has the symmetry of this bidirectional, so the dipoles, generalized dipoles. And so if you wish to understand what was predicted by Bogdanov and Gablonski for these magnetic skirmions, basically it tells if you have a crystal paramagnetic phase, which has the symmetry which is chiral of this chiral bidirectional, and add ferromagnetic phase transition to that, then you will get Bloch skirmions. And if you have ferroelectric one, you get Nernst skirmions. This is in some more general case. Now, what is our question here, because we are also interested in ferroelectrics, do we have this kind of things in ferroelectrics? And we have. There was a big step forward recently in several papers showing that we can have curling polarization in ferroelectric superlattices. And so actually we have some tubes in our ferroelectric materials now experimentally proven, which has the symmetry of the G vector, like here, because it basically rotates. But I'd like to say that the reason for existence of this fancy phenomena at nanoscale in this superlattices is, of course, as understood by also our theoretician in ferroelectricity, is the interface. It's the interfacial phenomena. It only happens when you have this particular thickness of the material, and if it's surrounded by this insulator, which actually making something which is equivalent to Kittel closure domains. But of course, it's not exactly proper language to talk about closure domains, because we have it in nanoscale thickness of domain walls. It's almost same as domains, etc. Anyway, interestingly, in these materials, it was shown that we have emerging chirality. So each of these curl actually contains of polarization. The symmetry combines P, G, and C dipoles at the same time. And so if you look for the topological or symmetry aspect of these tubes, they are the same as skirmions. And if you would think about geometry, then maybe this one's the ferroelectric bubbles could be called skirmion bubbles, because then really we have in the macroscopic, in the sample, we have skirmion density which adds up to the same number. But I would like to talk about something else. I dream of a material in which we would have the direct analogy of the Bogdanov-Jablonski scenario for ferroelectrics. It means that we would not have these topological bubble domains which have just skirmion topology, but we would also have intrinsic bulk driving term which goes to the same phenomenology as predicted by Bogdanov-Jablonski. So, I mean, can we have the same kind of free energy, the bulk free energy, with something like Jaworzynski-Moria term, which gives the same phenomena? And it means I would like to replace in this Jaworzynski-Moria term the magnetization polarization, and hoping that we should have the same phenomenology, so the same phase diagram and same phenomena, where the distance and between skirmion vortices should be defined by intrinsic interaction of the material. Now, where to look for this material? Well, one thing is interesting, that if you look for the symmetry of the magnetic Jaworzynski-Moria interaction, which gives Bloch skirmions, magnetic Bloch skirmions, is the symmetry is C, is the chiral bidirector. And if you put their polarization, is the same symmetry, also chiral bidirector. So it suggests that maybe we have a chance. So the conditions to have the same phenomenology, actually, we are looking for proper ferroelectric, uniaxial eases anisotropy, and carry bidirectional symmetry of the Heitz temperature phase. And so we can look what are the possible high symmetry phases which are chiral, allows the chiral bidirector. We can select the ones which are uniaxial, and we can look now through our table of all 212 species which are the proper phase transitions which with polarization along the same axis which fulfills all the criteria. And it turns out that there are just three cases. So if you wish to have the same phenomenology, same phase diagram as is in Bogdanov-Jablonski's Kirmions, we are looking for materials in which the symmetry is changing in this way, one of these three. Of course, there are many problems. How do we find them? How do we calculate whether they are good ones, where to go in the phase diagram? But anyway, I'm coming to the summary of my talk. So in the first part of the talk, would like to tell you that now we married the idea of vector-like quantities with species, and we have a table which is available on ConMat. And also, I'd like to make some suggestions for looking for new materials, new family of materials with intrinsic Bloch-Kirmion ferroelectric phases. And the message is that ferroelectric analog of chiral DMI, bulk interaction, exists. And we know where to look in these species. With that, I'd like to make some summary of, let's say, thank for the support to my colleagues, Petro Ondrejkovic and Vasek, which was much involved in the beginning of this KCR, which helps to do most of the work I presented today. And thank you for your attention.
For a couple questions.
In the early part of your talk, you had the half-filled circles, and I may have understood it at one time, but I don't remember. So can you give an example of a case of the half-filled circle?
So, example of partial. So for example, barium titanate room temperature tetragonal phase is full ferroelectric, but partial ferroelastic. It means I have six domain states. All of them can be distinguished by polarization, therefore it's full. But they cannot be distinguished, for example, by n, if n would be direction along the dilatation of the lattice, because there are only three directions. So some of the states, for example, position up and down, would have the same n.
Really interesting talk. For the second part about the skirmions, do you have materials in mind, and are we going to have to do anything? Unlike the superlattices, I think your implication is we're not going to have to structure these, but is there anything we're going to have to do to kind of coax these effects come out? What do you think?
Well, we have in the lab two materials which have been previously studied, which has the cis symmetry reduction, and we are looking for them. If you would like to know more which one, ask me in the break. But more I would like to really encourage the whole community to look for these cases. Maybe you know the better one. I mean, we have to find the suitable one.
So all these supergroups are piezoelectric, I guess?
Sorry?
I mean, do you not have any inversion symmetry in the supergroups? Is there any insight about that? I mean, is that a coincidence or?
The ferroelectric analog of Jeloshinsky-Moria interaction requires non-center symmetricity of the material. So it has to have chiral symmetry. The high temperature phase has to have this chiral symmetry by the reactor has to be allowed. And you wish to apply electric field along direction of the of this dipole.
All right.
So you need to have right-handed or left-handed material.
All right. I think it's time for us to take the break. So let's thank the speaker again. And I believe the group.